Welcome to the Calvary Baltimore Weekly Sermon. Here's today's teaching.
All right, turn your Bibles to, John chapter 10. Let's do that. Ooh, this is comfort. Good night, everybody. John chapter 10. Going to look at the Good Shepherd. Rob tells me that when I taught this in 2003, that's why he came to the church. So I figured I'll make one up that drives him out of the church, and we'll even things up. Okay, here we go. The Good Shepherd, or the Cruel Shepherd, depending upon how I want to do this. A little bit more?
I don't think you're on.
What?
Let's
make sure I'm on. Am I on? All right, can you hear now? All right. Don't start any trouble. I'm getting cranky in my old age. Okay, where am I? I'll tell you, it's been a long time since I've done this. Now you know why. All right, here we go. It is 9:53. Coming straight at you. The Good Shepherd. John 10, truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens, the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all of his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. So Jesus again say, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. Now, some of you were at the Bible study Friday. You're going to hear some things again, but there's all kinds of fresh stuff, so don't tune me out. A sheepfold would be an enclave of rocks that would protect the sheep. It was, you know, typically a wall, and the shepherd himself would be the door. He would lay across the entrance to the sheepfold. So you have this picture developing here. In verse 11, I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I've received from my Father. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. That's key there. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than I. And no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. You have a picture of double protection there. We're in the Son's hand, and his hand is in the Father's hand. So there's this concept of protection that's taking place. But I like to look at the big picture. I like to take this whole concept of a good shepherd back to even Genesis and then develop it, okay? So let's take a look at this. Number one, we are put in God's hand. We're engaged to God. We're the wedding ring on God's finger. And who is going to pry you from those nail-scarred hands? Nobody. That's what he's saying here. Just this certain security, this double security. Remember, salvation is all God's doing. It's a gift of God. We were dead in trespasses and sins, made alive by God's own blood. Paul tells us in the book of Acts that he purchased us with his very blood. We were as dead spiritually as Lazarus will be in John chapter 11. He was 4 days dead. He was melting, essentially just disintegrating into a mess, and then, you know, he could do nothing. And as the angel said at the empty tomb, when the disciples came there, they said, well, what are you looking for here for? Don't find the living among the dead. You're never going to find that. You know, he's alive. And that's the whole thing here. It says, don't seek the living among the dead. So know that you're dead. Know that if God doesn't do it, it's not going to be done. Now, God from the very beginning always intended to marry heaven to earth. So in Genesis, when God breathed his life into dust, he was marrying heaven to earth right off the bat. And when Jesus came, he came to seek a bride, and the two became one. The Bible begins with a wedding, and the Bible ends with a wedding. And of course, an explanation of what all this means, Paul in Ephesians 5 will say this: husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without spot. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as his own body. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church. Because we are members of his body, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. A lot of reading, but now there's going to be, we're going to speed things up here. So you have a picture of Jesus, the second Adam, in another garden, put in a deep sleep by the Father. The Spirit opens up his side, and he purchases his bride. As God fashions his bride, you and I, when we believe in him by the Holy Spirit, then God consummates the marriage in entering into us by the Holy Spirit. You see that picture? What a picture of marriage and its intentions. And now we become his holy of holies. We've become his dwelling place, his naos, in other words. It's the holy of holies in the Greek. And we become one while we're on earth. And while we're on earth, we're the wedding ring and his finger. Okay? We will be presented to him as a glorious, spotless bride because of the blood of Christ. Remember, our shepherd as our husband as well. And he is defined by self-giving. John 3:16, most popular scripture there is, for God so loved the world, he gave. He gave all of himself. He withheld nothing from you. He didn't withhold his hands, his feet, his side, his head. He opened up his heart to have you forever, okay? God loves to give himself away. He is life itself, and he's animated by his desire to fill all that he's created with his glory. It's an expression of his exuberant generosity. And what he did in the beginning, he didn't have to do this, but he saturated the world with colors and shapes and signs and sound. I was watching a special on deep sea creatures. And I got to tell you, some of you look like, no, I'm just messing. Some of those creatures were, whoo! I mean, and it's like, wow, nobody sees them, but the colors, the shapes, their ability to change at camouflage and with the background, okay? So he just makes these things that can, sounds and notes and feelings that move us, that move our souls, because he's including us in the things of heaven. He did this because of his overflowing abundance of love and creativity. And he's creating in you. The greatest power in the universe is in you, recreating you into what he intended you to be. And above all, we see in John 17, Jesus is going home. It's his high priestly prayer. He says, Father, I'm coming home. I'm bringing some friends with me. They're messy. They do stupid things. They talk about tushy cushions and stuff like that. But I died for them, Father. And above all, I want them to be with me to see my glory. God longs more than anything for you to be with him and see his glory. The last description in the Bible is, and then we saw his face. We saw his face, the face of God. Your face is on a milk carton in heaven. It's an empty place there at the table for you. And when you come home, he's not going to say, why'd you do this, why'd you do that? He's going to say, have some cookies.
Yeah.
Just sit with me. Let me count your freckles. It's our Father. And he's more human than we could ever imagine. It's where we get this. And so God creates a world and places it in a living, breathing image of himself in the garden. And Yahweh, which is his covenant name, he gives the earth everything under heaven to us. Heaven belongs to Yahweh. But he shares that heaven with us. And you'll see all throughout scripture that the Bible heavenizes creation. And then in the end, we're going to see that at last he humanizes heaven. There is a man who was our bone of bone and flesh of flesh, who we wounded and tortured and slaughtered. Our older brother, our great shepherd, our high priest, our king, who's one with us. He wants us to be there with him. He finally humanizes heaven after heavenizing the earth. We come here on Sundays to be heavenized, to meet God, so we can go back out into the world and heavenize the world, so that God can humanize heaven, take those people to heaven. I know that sounded like Kamala Harris, but I tried to get... I just couldn't get it all together, you know. I grew up in a middle-income family. We took care of the lawn. Anyway, let's just move on. I got to stop watching the news. I just screwed that whole thing up. But even if you exist, it's God's gift, his blessing. He not only created you, but he sustained you. We're told in Colossians that he holds everything together. And scientists talk about this black matter that they don't understand that holds everything together. We know. Bible says we know more than our teachers because I know your word. Yep. You're smarter than the brightest people in the world to know Christ because you have the brightest mind in you. We are the mind of Christ. That's what Paul tells us. Think of the Trinity in this area of self-giving. From eternity past, the Father gives out from himself to the Son. The Son to the Father and the Spirit back and forth. It's God's character to go out of himself, to give of himself to another person. He is ecstatic in giving himself out to love people. And it was a gratuitous act of love. That's why he created. He loves to give himself away. And the cross, of course, was the supreme manifestation of his self-giving glory. And it was a demonstration of his deepest love. And we were created to be like him. But here's Adam and Eve. Let's go back to the beginning again. Adam is a shepherd. He's under the command of the great shepherd. Adam was also the first priest on the earth. He was supposed to represent the character of God to all creation. And then came Eve. She just kept fishing and ignored the whole thing, but he got in trouble. But he was supposed to manifest generosity and selflessness and all these things. And then God formed a helper from his side. She too was to be the same. And they called her Eve, the mother of all living. But Adam and Eve undid all of God's generosity by taking, by selfishness. Grasping for what wasn't theirs, they ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They had one command and they disobeyed it. And you see what's happening here. Pretty soon, Adam's blaming his wife. His wife is blaming the serpent and that God, you know, on and on it goes. And then they show up in front of Judge Judy and it's a mess. But what is Adam's failure? I will not be a servant and give away as the great shepherd is. I will take. I will take. I will be God. I know what's right and wrong. That's what's wrong with our society. Everybody's doing what's right in their own eyes. I've been watching you guys. You're in big trouble, half of you here. Got your names, addresses, everything down here. But this is what he says. He takes God's place as God. Let me tell you something. The essence of sin is man taking God's place as God. But the essence of salvation is God taking our place in judgment. And that's the very essence of it all. And then, of course, their offspring, Cain, killed his own brother, Abel. Adam and Eve were made to be one, but sin divides what God joins together. We've exchanged the truth of God for taking and lying and stealing, all trying to make our own pathetic paradise. You see, these politicians will do anything to get that kind of power. They'll lie, they'll kill, they'll steal, they'll do whatever. There's an old saying, how do you know if a politician's lying? His lips are moving. All right, and we're in trouble as a country, but God found us drowning in our own selfishness and cruelty. We were made to give ourselves away. Jesus came giving, doing everything for man, and man, who he was trying to save, did everything against him. Crucify him. Let his blood be on our heads, and it did come, and our children's heads. Jesus was saving them. They demanded his death. There is more glory in those bleeding wounds than all the theology books in the world. You want to grow deeper in Christ, you go straight to those wounds and find out what they mean and what God explains about them. Now, the self-sacrificing shepherd husband comes to lay his life down for his sheep, for his bride. 700 years before this, we see Yahweh in chapter 6 of Isaiah call his prophet Isaiah in to deal with his people. They were no longer hearing his voice. My sheep hear my voice, and they follow me. They no longer followed him. They've been deprived of their senses. And the Bible says they became like the idols they serve. They have eyes but can't see. They have ears they can't hear. And so he sends Isaiah with a new heart and a new mouth and new words to recreate a new human being, restored from idolatry and from the effects of it. So in Isaiah 50, it says, the Lord has given me the tongue of those who are taught, that I may know how to sustain with the word. He who is weary, morning by morning he awakens my ear to hear as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I turned not back. I gave my back to those who strike, and my cheeks to those who pull out the beard. And I hide not my face from disgrace and spitting. Yahweh gives the man a new tongue so that he can speak his word to his sheep. It is the tongue of one who is taught, and a taught one in turn teaches. An awakened ear, an obedient ear, is the kind of sacrifice the great shepherd wants. The sacrifice of an opened ear. And now you and I become God's voice. There's 7 billion people on this planet. You're surrounded by people who are heading for hell. And there we stand with our mouth shut, when we've been called to be his voice to a broken world. God loves those people that we don't give time to. We're all guilty of it. All of us. Remember, Paul says, we implore you, God is making his appeal through you for the world to be reconciled to Christ. We're his ambassadors. Now, in the Middle East, the sheep were the wealth of the shepherd. The shepherd's joy and honor and glory is wrapped up in his sheep. This is what Jesus is saying to us. You're my glory. You're my greatest value. You're my joy. If you ain't happy, I ain't happy. He's committed to our well-being. And I'm laying my life down for the sheep, he says. But listen, it's instead of the sheep. Substitution here. Substitution. Okay, every other shepherd, every other leader of the major world religions die. But our shepherd lives within us. He becomes us on the cross. He becomes a sacrificial lamb. And what he's saying here, and they would know this, I would rather lose my life than lose one of my sheep. I am not going to be that guy, and this is on a human level, that was the first shepherd to lose a sheep. My father never did, my grandfather never did, my great-grandfather never did, and I'm not about to. He's getting across the point that his glory and his reputation and his honor is in keeping you safe in his hands. And he's also saying here that these Pharisees are not faithful shepherds. They come to steal, kill, and destroy. Which he says, you have authority to take it back up again. Why? Because when the shepherd dies, the wolves come in and eat the sheep. This shepherd has to live again. If it pleased the Father to crush him, what must he feel for you? The depth of, we don't know that kind of love. Behold, what manner of love is this that God would call us his children? Soon he'll be heading up to Gethsemane. Gethsemane means oil press. It's a statement on human suffering. There is a crushing that takes place, and you can almost see the Father's hand pressing down on the Son, forcing the blood out of his face. And you know, olives can only give light when they're crushed. And grapes can only give wine when they're crushed. And Jesus can only give us life when he is crushed. And here he's being squeezed in the Mount of Olives there, sweating drops of blood. Even he's embracing the monster and throwing him to the ground and crushing the head of the serpent, with the serpent biting his heel. When he finally gets to Golgotha, the place of the skull, he said, I go to prepare a place for you. And he's been doing it for 2,000 years. And the first piece of construction was a wooden plank growing out of the ground soaked with his blood. He crushes the serpent's head right there on the place of the skull. Golgotha. You know that Goliath's head was put under that hill. David put it there. Not one little thing in the Bible isn't carefully projected to us with God's great wisdom. And they tore him apart, the wolves did. Tore him apart. Sin turned man into a ruined cathedral. Now, the ultimate psalm about the shepherd. There's some explaining to do before we get here. First of all, Psalm 22 is set right before it. And Jesus here is, David is writing in the spirit of Christ. And he's saying, I'm surrounded by the vicious beasts. I will be devoured instead of my sheep, essentially what he's saying. He describes these people as animals that just want to tear him apart. And this precedes Psalm 23. Now listen carefully. You have to understand Hebrew poetry if you're going to really get the full impact of this psalm. And I'll explain that in a little bit. But in Psalm 23, he says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I'll just give you the basic meaning, then I want to get into the deeper meaning. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Every other shepherd, every leader of major world religions die and just leave you there teaching. But he indwells us. No sheep has ever had such great value placed on him. He restores my soul, leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He causes me to repent and return to the shepherd. He does. Why does he do it? For God's reputation. God's reputation is intricately interwoven with the sheep, you see. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and staff, they comfort me. Death is just a shadow. You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. It's a banquet. The banquet feast reflects the return of the parable of the prodigal son, where the father prepared a feast and the older brother was angry, representing the Pharisees. Now, here we go. Give me your attention, freshly. In Hebrew poetry, you have to understand that the book of Psalms is a meditation on God's law. It's the soul. It's the soul of God's law. It's the Holy Spirit's meditation on the law. And within all that is God's dwelling place with man. We see it in the narrative of the Torah. God is always trying to live with man in some fashion or way. Okay, it's the establishment of God dwelling with man. And so you'll see some of these things, especially in Psalm 23. But God's dwelling with man is interrupted as soon as Genesis, where we have the sin of Adam and Eve. But the ideal of this has not been abandoned. We see the story of Noah is riddled with indications of replanting Eden. That's what the olive branch was all about when the dove came back to the ark. And then, of course, the people in Babel attempted to build a pseudo-Eden. And we all know what happened to that. And so the book of Leviticus as well shows the intersection of God's house and man's neighborhood. While they were 40 years in the wilderness, they had the tent of meeting, and they were the church, folks, is a tent moving through this world, moving through Cana. And God brings us, and 41 times he says, it's a tent of meeting. I'm going to meet you there. Look at the sky. The sky will tell you when we're supposed to meet, how we're supposed to meet. But this is what we have to understand when we look at this. In Hebrew poetry, it's about moving higher and higher and deeper into the things of God. And you're going to see this in a minute. Always advancing to a higher level. A forward dynamic motion in its roots, just pushing the sap forward to a greater truth, a more deliberate truth. Pushing life out for man's flourishing. It's a captivating story where each reader has the chapter push them forward to see how the whole fits together. You're going to see this in Psalm 23 very shortly. It pushes us beyond the text into our lives and shapes our lives in the mold of Scripture. The words of God through the Psalms enter into the realm of men, forming it, dividing it, recreating it from glory to glory. The psalm begins with the words, Good Shepherd, and the word shepherd pushes everything forward in the song. He becomes not only the shepherd, but the master of the feast and the priest and the king. He'll have his head anointed with oil. He's the shepherd king. Now, what this psalm does is it pictures man's transformation from beast to priest and king, from sheep to the good shepherd. I want you to think about this. Two people in the Bible have had their garments, their clothes, designed by God in the Torah. Adam and Eve, what did he give them? Beastly covering. He said, you're living like a beast. You're just living by your desires. There you are. You're covered in sheepskin or whatever. And the priests, they were glorious garments. Imagine you're in the middle of this dead desert and there's life nowhere and you've got nothing but sand that's colorless, and out of that comes this beautiful, radiant high priest with glorious, like frozen bits of rainbow, they call it, you know, just this gorgeous thing. So the first one was beastly, while the second one is otherworldly, heavenly. So the tabernacle process tracks in 23 the transformation, and all of us as believers, clothed as beasts, we're sons of Adam, and eventually ending up clothed in glory as priests, as, you know, children of God. And so from entering the complex, the temple complex as an animal, effectively to being seated with God at home in his glory, Psalm 23 tracks this transformation. Remember, David proceeded to gather all the materials for the temple. Solomon made the temple. Remember, the temple worshiper would press their hands into the sacrifice and become one with it. All of these things. But David enters the temple as a sacrificial lamb. And what does he come upon when he first comes into the courtyard? The bronze laver with water. He makes me lie down in green pastures beside still waters. Interesting. Then he says, he restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Three times a year, the men in Israel were to travel to the tabernacle, offering themselves to God. These are the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He's developing something here. He goes further into the courtyard. And what does he meet there? Or actually into the tabernacle area. What does he meet there? He meets a mountain of fire. It's reflective of Sinai. It was developed specifically to reflect Sinai, the burning, thunderous God. He comes to the base of this mountain, and there at the top is the fiery judgment of God that everybody was afraid of. He came to the valley of the shadow of death. It was a raised formation of uncut stones and a blaze of fire like at Sinai. Then he goes from the altar into the holy place to a feast. Jesus, the bread of life, he was born in Bethlehem. Bethlehem means house of bread. Jesus, the bread of life, creates man as a hunger. You were made as a hunger. And then he invites you to feast on his soul. He's got it all covered, folks. When you check out, when they're instructed to offer up these sacrifices in Leviticus, we won't have time to go there, but it says, bring the sacrifice near. Bring the sacrifice. Do you know what's being said there in Hebrew? Bring it close to God's mouth. You're offered up to God. It's the picture of you offering the sacrifice, because God's going to consume the spiritually the sacrifice. You bring it close to God's mouth. That's what the wording means. You bring it near to God. And the whole thing would be burned up, and it's a picture of the whole man ascending into the presence of God. He is called, it's called in Leviticus an ascension. It's called bridal food. It's marriage food. And then he gets his head anointed with oil. My cup overflows. He's anointed both king and priest. And in the holy place, he's treated like a priest, and he's anointed like a priest. And then and he finds a table prepared for him there. And then surely goodness and mercy, a picture of the goodness and mercy like sheepdogs. Chasing the sheep home, shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So David here is reflecting our movement of ascension as a sheep from one realm to the next, from glory to greater glory, as we see the face of Jesus Christ. Having entered as a sacrificial lamb, closes with him as an anointed priest, and that's what we are called to do, okay? Now, he says this, I've come to give you abundant life. The Hebrew, the Greek there is zoe. It's this abundance of life. When the Holy Spirit comes within you, And you cry out, Abba, Father, the spirit of adoption in so many different ways. When you are brought to the point where you say, God, forgive me, I'm sorry, I need your mercy. Father, forgive me, I need your mercy. That is the first note of heaven's song. That rises in your heart and expands. It's the sign that a newborn child is coming alive. We get that final spank on the butt from God the Father. And, I'm sorry. We see every time somebody comes to the Lord, there's a party in heaven. God, the Gospels tell this. You know, you take your infant child, and how hard do you work trying to get that kid to say back to you, I love you? I mean, it's everything. I love you. I love you. And you want to see that reciprocal response, right? The Father longs to hear that from us. He, by the way, the first breath you ever take, you'll pronounce Yahweh's name. And the last breath you ever take, you will pronounce his name. And if you ever just pronounce it, Yahweh, notice your tongue doesn't touch the roof of your mouth or the teeth or anything. There's no obstruction. It's just pure air. Yahweh, because he's spirit. He's put his spirit in you. So who's going to take something from God? Listen, he's going to take you home. But like me, you're probably going to struggle and complain all the way. But let me tell you this. There's far more of God's hand in your life than your own hand. And you don't realize it, but boy, let me tell you, your will is much harder on you than his will. Okay? God is recreating us into his own image, and there's some surgery. It can be painful. Grace can be very painful. It's always surprising. He has to reassure us over and over and over again of these things. Grace shocks, no matter how many times you experience it. How many of you remember Britain's Got Talent, Susan Boyle? Remember her? Unbelievable. One person who wrought for an entertainment magazine wrote this. Listen to this. Susan Boyle is not your typical looking star. People were shocked when they heard her voice, and one writer in an entertainment magazine said this, I'm still stuck on Susan Boyle and still weeping. I play the YouTube clip over and over of Miss Boyle, a frumpy, middle-aged British lady who marched out on the stage of the national TV show Britain's Got Talent. She bided her time through the judgmental hoots and snickers of the studio audience and judges. She sang I Dream a Dream from Les Mis. And she brought a worldwide audience to their feet and to her feet with the grandeur of her voice. Right now, I'm pondering why the experience of watching and listening to Miss Boyle makes so many viewers cry, me among them. And I think I've got a simple answer, at least for me. And our pop-minded culture, so slavishly obsessed with packaging the right face, the right clothes, the right attitude, the right Facebook post, the unpackaged artistic power of the unstyled, unhip, unkissed Miss Boyle. Let me feel for the duration of one blazing, show-stopping moment. Boyle, let me feel the meaning of human grace. She reordered the measure of beauty. I had no idea until the tears sprung how desperately I needed that corrective. When I heard Miss Boyle, I realized I had forgotten what true grace and beauty was. It was a deep inner thing. Isn't that how we approach the cross? We want to make the gospel like a Christmas tree. We want to hang our favorite things on. It's not a Christmas tree. It's an execution instrument. Yes. What is more unhip and uncool to the world than that? And Paul says it is the power and the wisdom of God. In other words, God thought and thought and thought, said this is the only way to do it. He came to the end of his own life to get this done for us. I'll wrap this up in a minute or two. You believe me? Suckers. In 1 Corinthians 2, we're told that God the Holy Spirit is within us, and that he reveals to us, from his spirit to ours, the deep things of God. That the eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. The deep things of God speak to the deep things he's placed within us. Deep calls unto deep. And in Psalm 42, David is feeling overwhelmed with life. He feels like he's drowning. And he says, deep calls unto deep as the water surrounds me. And he'll say, why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you cast down within me? Deep calls unto deep at the roar of your waterfalls. All your breakers and waves have gone over me. Lord commands steadfast love at night. His song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I said to God, my rock, why have you forgot me? And I say, why are you cast down, my soul? The answer he gets is, I hope in God I will praise him again. Now, in the beginning of the earth, you had the water below and the water above. But in the beginning, they were all one. They were one source. And David speaks of the skies above agitating the seas below. Deep calling unto deep and stirring the other one. What? It's that the sky was saying to the water below, we're brothers. We were once one. And the world in the beginning was covered with darkness and water, and God spoke and separated those waters. Every drop of rain is brother to the next drop in the ocean. And so too, you and I are brothers with whoever, wherever they live, in Baltimore or Europe. We're birthed from the same source. Deep calls unto deep. And it says, let's be one again. And we cry out back to God in our repentance and longing. And the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. And let me tell you something. There is no deeper dialogue you will ever have ever in life than when you sit at the foot of the cross and hear God's word. You're having a conversation. The deep things of God are calling out to the deep things he's placed in you. And then you respond. You respond with tears and joy. And it's just something the world doesn't understand. We're told that the Spirit helps us pray in our weakness when we don't understand it. Now, finally, quickly getting back to the tabernacle, one of the things that kind of parallels this deep calls unto deep idea is that when you burned incense in the tabernacle, the glory cloud of God would come down and meet that incense. So your glory would rise. Incense is a teaching on glory, trust me. So when your glory rises, the depths of who you are rises to God, the depths of God comes down and meets you. And the two join. As the theology of glory, God had promised to meet his people. Descending glory meets with ascending glory. When you pray, you're not throwing words to a distant God. He's in you, and he's helping you pray. Do you understand? All of God Almighty is in you and for you. What are you worried about? Even death, what are you worried about? It'll put you in the best state you could ever dream of. Now, you might want to kill me after I said that, but try to refrain. So let's stand very quickly. We could stand. Don't need the worship team yet. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' wonderful name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Let's worship.
That's today's message from Calvary Baltimore. Thanks for joining us. If you'd like to know more about us, visit calvarychapelbaltimore.org. Our email address is calvarybaltimore1@gmail.com. That's calvarybaltimore, then the number 1, at gmail.com. To financially support the work God is doing through Calvary Baltimore, go to calvarychapelbaltimore.org and click Give. And if you're in the area, stop by on a Sunday morning. For directions and service times, go to our website at calvarychapelbaltimore.org. Live streams and weekly sermons are available on our website, our Facebook page, and YouTube. You can also watch with our mobile app and on Apple TV and Roku. Search for Calvary Chapel Baltimore on these platforms for instant access to great Bible teaching and encouragement. We hope you've been blessed by this week's teaching. Until next time, as Pastor Josh says, study the Word, to live the Word, to share the Word. And join us again for the next Calvary Baltimore Weekly Sermon.